I'm Matthew Spaulding, Associate Vice President and Dean of Educational Programs for Hillsdale College in Washington, D.C. Welcome to the Alan P. Kirby Center for Constitutional Studies and Citizenship. Hillsdale College is an independent institution of higher learning founded in 1844 by men and women grateful to God for the inestimable blessings resulting from civil and religious liberty. The history of our college, and I was actually just talking to our speaker outside, is as has always been associated with and is very much affiliated with the cause of abolition. Frederick Douglass having spoken there several times, and many of Hillsdale's students fighting the Civil War, many nobly dying, and several of them receiving great honors, including three, if our account is correct, being honor guard at Lincoln's funeral. So we're very happy to host this discussion this evening. The purpose of the center, the Kirby Center here in Washington, D.C., is to extend the college's teaching mission to the nation's capital, teaching students and citizens, leaders, about the principles and politics of American constitutionalism. Our speaker this evening is the author of many books, many wonderful books, about some of America's greatest statesmen, Washington, Hamilton, Madison. But he joins us this evening to speak about his new book, not on another founder, but rather on another statesman, Abraham Lincoln, who, in America's greatest crisis, turned to the founders for guidance. A native of upstate New York, Richard Brookhiser made his debut in the pages of National Review at the age of 15. He would go into college, graduate from Yale in 1977, then to work for the National Review, where he has remained ever since, now serving as a senior editor. For 20 years, he's been a columnist and regular writer for the New York Observer, and his writings appear in many places: The New Yorker, The New York Times, The Wall Street Journal, Atlantic Monthly, Time, Vanity Fair, and one could go on. Along the way, I'm very happy to say, and observed and read, he's become a wonderful writer of history, a gifted writer of history, I might say, and a historian of the founding period. In addition to his many books, he curated Alexander Hamilton, The Man Who Made Modern America, an exhibition at the New York Historical Society. And he's written and hosted Rediscovering George Washington and a second one, Rediscovering Alexander Hamilton, films by Michael Pack, friend of ours, both of which aired on PBS. He's frequently interviewed expert on a number of History Channel documentaries. In addition to his duties at National Review, he is also a columnist for American History. In 2008, he was awarded the National Medal of the Humanities. And in 2011, he was awarded a Guggenheim Fellowship. So I'm very happy to have a dear friend of mine and Hillsdale College is here this evening. And I'd like you to join me in welcoming the author of A Founder's Son, Life of Abraham Lincoln, Mr. Richard Brookhiser.
Well, thank you, Matt, for that introduction. And thank you all for coming. I have spoken here at the Kirby Center, and I've spoken at the Mothership in Michigan. And I have to tell you, it's a lot easier to get to the Kirby Center than it is to the campus. You can just walk up from Union Station, and you don't have to drive an hour and a half from the nearest airport, as you do, to get to Hillsdale. Abraham Lincoln was deeply involved with the Founding Fathers. He turned to them for inspiration and for guidance, and he used them to persuade his fellow Americans and to lead them. Probably his most famous citation was in the Gettysburg Address in November of 1863, where he said, "Our fathers brought forth on this continent a new nation conceived in liberty." But 3 years before that, in the Cooper Union Address, New York City in February 1860. This was the kickoff of his first presidential campaign. He said of slavery, "As our fathers marked it, so let it be again marked, as an evil not to be extended. Let us speak as they spoke and act as they acted upon it." And then 6 years before that, in his speech in Peoria, Illinois, in October 1854, which was really the beginning of his mature political career, he said, "Our Republican robe is soiled and trailed in the dust. Let us turn and wash it white in the spirit of the revolution. Let us return slavery to the position our fathers gave it." So what I want to do tonight is just talk about the three founding fathers who I think were most influential to Lincoln, and they were George Washington, Thomas Paine, and Thomas Jefferson. And I want to talk about two other fathers, his actual father, his biological father, Thomas Lincoln. And I think one reason for the passion that Lincoln brought to the founding fathers is that he found his own father disappointing in a lot of ways. And the second father, especially in the Civil War, is God the Father, to which Lincoln turned, because even the founding fathers were no longer enough to explain what was happening to him and to the nation. So to begin with Thomas Lincoln. Thomas Lincoln was a Virginian who moved to Kentucky. He married there and had a family, a daughter Sarah, son Abraham, and a little boy Thomas who died after 3 days. When Abraham was 7, they moved to the brand new state of Indiana, and when Abraham was 21, they moved on to Illinois, where Thomas Lincoln lived for the rest of his life. He was a farmer and a carpenter, and he was a responsible man in many ways. He never went broke. He never left bad debts. He served on several juries, which was a sign of respectability in the communities he lived in. He was the trustee of the Baptist church that the Lincolns worshiped in Indiana. And when his first wife, Nancy Lincoln, died when Abraham was 11, after a year, he went back from Indiana to Kentucky. He found an old friend of his, herself a widow, Sarah Bush Johnston. He married her, brought her back to Indiana so that his children would have a mother and there would be someone to tend his house. But Thomas Lincoln and his son never really got along. They never saw eye to eye. Lincoln sent his children, Sarah and Abraham, to schools. He wanted them to know how to read and write. And Abraham went to 5 schools over the course of his youth, 2 when he was a little boy in Kentucky, 3 more in Indiana. These were one-room affairs. If you add up all the time he spent in all 5 of them, it's only 1 year. But he did learn how to read, how to write, and how to do basic arithmetic. And these were skills that his father wanted him to have. But his father could not understand the passion for reading, which is what his son felt. For Abraham, reading was something that took him out of himself, also took him deeper into himself. It was a way to enlarge his view of the world and to deepen his view of it. The boy would read any book that he could get his hands on. If he didn't understand what he read, he would ask, "What does this mean?" He would write it down in his own words. Then he would rewrite it to make sure he understood what he'd read. And if he didn't have paper, he'd write it on a board with charcoal. And when he filled up the board, he'd plane the board over so he could write again. We know all this from his stepmother, Sarah Bush, now Lincoln, who was a very observant woman and really got that her stepson was special. But this was something that his own father never understood, never bonded with him about. When Lincoln was 21, Abraham Lincoln was 21, he went off on his own. And all he said of his father in a campaign autobiography in 1860 was that he never learned more than to bunglingly write his own name. I think there's a lot of scorn in that word, bunglingly. He's saying, I learned to write my own name, and I learned to write more. And you could have, but you didn't. And that's a kind of a painful symbol of their divergence. Nevertheless, I think Abraham did get three things from his father. One was strength. They were differently built. Thomas Lincoln was 5'10 and stocky. Abraham, of course, was 6'4 and lean. But they were both strong young men. And this enabled them to face the communal hazing, which was routine in rural America. If you were moving into a new community, you were a young man, you had to prove yourself against the local tough guy. And both Thomas Lincoln and Abraham Lincoln were able to do this and pass this test. So that was an inheritance. A second inheritance was that Thomas Lincoln was temperate. And early America, early 19th century America, was a nation of alcoholics. Gordon Wood wrote a book recently where he gives the statistics on how much people drank. It's dismaying, astonishing. But Thomas Lincoln was a non-drinker, and so was his son. So that was a second inheritance. The third, the most important, was that Thomas was a great storyteller. We know this from two cousins on the mother's side, on the first wife's side, John and Dennis Hanks. And one of them said that Thomas Lincoln was as good a storyteller as Abraham. The other one said he was better. So this must have been a skill that Abraham heard at home, and it stimulated and honed his own abilities in this line. But Abraham never mentioned those qualities, never acknowledged them. Thomas died in 1851. Abraham named a horse after his father, Old Tom, named one of his sons, Thomas. In 1861, when he's going, before he's going to his first inauguration, he visits his father's grave, and there's no stone on it. And he says to someone, I'll have to put a stone there, but he never did. So that was the story of father and son. But when we don't get everything we need or want from our families, and none of us ever does, none of us ever gets everything, we look for it elsewhere. We look for surrogates and we look for substitutes. And the surrogates that Abraham Lincoln found were the founding fathers. This was the generation just passed who had won the Revolution and established the Constitution. And many of these men were still alive and active in his boyhood. Thomas Jefferson is still in the White House when he's born. He's got one more month to serve there. He's followed by James Madison, founder of the Constitution, for 8 years. And he's followed by James Monroe, who's the last founding father president. And that takes Lincoln, Abraham Lincoln, through his teens. But by the time Abraham Lincoln is in his 20s, in the 1830s, the last of the founding fathers die. None of them ever came out to Indiana or Illinois, where Lincoln lived. He did not go east where they lived until years after this, and he certainly wasn't in their social class. So the only way he was going to connect with these men, the only way he could, was in books. And the first book, the most important, earliest connection, is the book The Life of General Washington by Mason Locke Weems, Parson Weems. Parson Weems was an ordained Episcopal clergyman, but he made his living as a publisher and a bookseller. He was itinerant. He'd go up and down the East Coast selling his stock of books. And he knew George Washington very slightly. He'd written Washington a letter, and he came to Mount Vernon once for a lunch. And Washington notes in his diary a list of people who showed up for lunch, and he has Weems is on the list. So they did have that contact. But Weems saw that a biography of Washington would be a bestseller. So Washington dies in December of 1799, and the next year, Weems is out with his book, The Life of General Washington. Then in 1808, he revises it, he expands it, and this is the version that Lincoln would have read, possibly as early as Kentucky, certainly by the time the family has moved to Indiana. And if you read Weems now, Weems is one of those writers like James Fenimore Cooper or H.P. Lovecraft. The prose is not good, but the stories are terrific. And the proof is that we still remember some of these stories. They have made their way into our consciousness. And the most familiar one, of course, is the story of the cherry tree. And this is, you know, George is a little boy, and his father gives him a hatchet. And in swinging it around, he accidentally chops the bark of a prized cherry tree. And then the father, Augustine Washington, he sees the damage to the tree, and he asks George, how did this happen? And George says, I cannot tell a lie, Pa. You know I cannot tell a lie. And he admits, I did it. And then his father praises him for his honesty. But that's not what impressed Lincoln in The Life of Washington. What impressed Lincoln was Weems' account of the Battle of Trenton, the crossing of the Delaware, and the desperate early morning attack on the Hessian garrison in Trenton at the lowest point of the American Revolution, the battle that saved it from an impending disaster and allowed the cause to go on. And we know that this is what impressed Lincoln because Lincoln himself said so in 1861, when he's on his way to his first inauguration. He leaves Springfield, his home, Springfield, Illinois, in February, and he takes a train through seven states. He speaks in six of them. He's showing the flag as the country is falling apart. And he goes through Trenton, New Jersey, the day before Washington's birthday, and he addresses the state legislature. And he tells the state Senate, he recalls reading Weems' Life of Washington when he was a boy, and reading about the Battle of Trenton in it. And he says, boy though I was, I realized that there must have been something more than independence that those men struggled for, something that would be of value to all men and all times. And that something was liberty. And if you go back to Weems and read Weems' account of the Battle of Trenton, that's exactly what Weems says is important. He describes the crossing of the Delaware. He gives a lot of pages to the Hessians. But his climactic moment is after the American troops have crossed the Delaware, and they still have a few miles to march before they get to Trenton, can launch their attack. He introduces an allegorical figure. It's a woman who's hovering over the line of march. And this is liberty. And Weems says, she's been driven out of Europe. The wilds of America are her last refuge. But her enemies have followed her. They followed her with soldiers and armies. Who's going to defend her? Only this ragged band of men. Weems is presenting the Battle of Trenton as a struggle for liberty in the world. And the words that he gives to Washington before the charge is, all I ask of you men is to remember what you are about to fight for. Well, in 1861, Lincoln remembered. And he told the New Jersey Senate, you all know, for you all have been boys, how impressions at that age last longer than others. Lincoln was not impressed by George Washington as a good boy. He was impressed by him as a great man who was fighting for liberty. The second founder to make an impression on Lincoln was Thomas Paine. And this happened when Lincoln was in his 20s and he had left the nest. Now Paine's greatness in the Revolution was as a crusading journalist. And I'm a journalist myself, and I think the lead paragraph of The American Crisis which was the pamphlet that he wrote before the Battle of Trenton, is the greatest lead paragraph that's ever been written or ever will be. This is the one, these are the times that try men's souls. I mean, it's just, it's King Harry's speech before Agincourt, but it's real. I mean, it's in real time and it's really happening. It's terrific stuff. And Lincoln read this in Indiana. He read the American Crisis. He read Common Sense, but he also read The Age of Reason, which was Paine's furious attack on revealed religion. Paine was not an atheist. He said, I believe in one God and no more. But he thought that all religions were set up, as he said, to terrify and enslave mankind. And so his book, he makes some cracks at Islam and he makes more at Judaism, but mostly this book is a furious attack on Christianity. And Paine describes his own, I guess you'd call it, unconversion experience. He says that when he was 7 or 8 years old, someone in his family read a sermon at home about the substitutionary atonement, about the doctrine that Christ died for our sins. And then Paine describes leaving the room, walking out into the garden, and he says, I revolted at the recollection of what I had heard and thought to myself that it was making God Almighty act like a passionate man that killed his son when he could not revenge himself any other way. And as I was sure a man would be hanged that did such a thing, I could not see for what purpose they preached such sermons. And this is Paine's technique. It's to take biblical words in their most literal sense and to assail them with what he would call common sense. It's like literalism standing on its head. And Paine is kind of the ideal adversary for a culture where people are Bible readers and take the Bible literally. And so Paine's challenge is, okay, if you take it literally, how do you explain this and this and this? And he combs the Bible for every inconsistency he can find, every contradiction. And of course, people have been attacking and explaining these for hundreds of years. But Paine is doing it in an American voice. So he's the fresh version of this. And as with many 20-somethings, Lincoln is very impressed. You know, he's no longer living with his parents. He's no longer going to the Baptist church. Here's this lively, combative man who's telling him this is all nonsense. You don't have to pay any attention to it. And he thinks, oh, great, this explains everything. He even wrote a pamphlet of his own, which argued that Jesus was an illegitimate child. And the only test for religion should be the test of reason. It's sort of a Paineite work that he produced. And he talked about it when he was a postmaster. This was one of the jobs he had in his early 20s. He went through a number of jobs before he figured out that law and politics were the thing for him. And in those days, postmasters did not have post offices. They worked in someone's store. They'd have a corner of it, and that's where all the letters came in and where people would come in to pick up their mail and their newspapers. So Lincoln is in this store telling all his pals that he's written this pamphlet. And then the owner of the store, a man named Samuel Hill, an older man, he asked to see the pamphlet, and he put it in the stove, and he burned it. Because Abraham Lincoln was already interested in politics, and Samuel Hill knew that you don't win votes in Illinois in the 1830s by attacking Christianity. So this pamphlet was never printed, and Lincoln never had to explain it or deny it. And so he learned to be discreet about some of these opinions, and I believe they did change over time, and I will get to that. But one thing he got from Paine that he never changed was one of Paine's techniques, because Paine showed him how to use humor in making serious arguments. Now, no one had to show Lincoln how to be funny. He already knew that. He'd already learned that from his father, from doing it himself, from hearing other people tell stories. He was already funny. But Paine showed him how you can use jokes to make serious points. because this is something that Paine is rather good at. For instance, one of his attacks on the virgin birth, he says, Paine says, if any young woman now were to say that she was made pregnant by a ghost and that an angel told her so, even if she swore to it, would she be believed? You know, and this is Paine. It's like taking it in the most literal way possible and trying to draw a laugh out of it. And Lincoln would use this technique himself over and over again. In the 1850s, when his Democratic opponents would say that Lincoln and other Republicans were for race mixing, because they wanted to restrict slavery, therefore they're pro-black, therefore they must want to marry black women. And Lincoln would say, just because I don't want a black woman for a slave doesn't mean I have to have her for a wife. I can just let her alone. So he's, all right, you're going to charge me with race mixing. Well, here's what I think of black women. You know, I don't want them for my slave. I don't want them for my wife. I can let them alone. But it's also a serious joke, because if you let the black woman alone, aren't you letting her be free? So whenever he tells this joke dozens of times, and when we have press accounts that give audience reactions, it always gets a laugh. But it's a laugh to make them think. It's a laugh to leave them thinking a little differently about that black woman who's not going to be Mrs. Lincoln, but also not going to be Lincoln's slave. So that is something I believe he did get from Thomas Paine of permanent value. And then the third founder who's very important for him is Thomas Jefferson. And he becomes important beginning in 1854. This is when the Nebraska Bill is passed, a bill to organize the remainder of the Louisiana Territory. The proposal is to form two territories, Kansas and Nebraska, and to let them have slavery or not, depending as the residents vote. And it's presented as all American. And we're about self-government. This is self-government in action. Who could quarrel with that? Well, the early Republican Party quarreled vehemently with it because these territories had been reserved for freedom in the Missouri Compromise of 1820. And in that deal, Missouri was admitted as a slave state, but the remainder of the Louisiana Territory, north of a certain line, which was Missouri's southern border, was going to be reserved to freedom. And all of a sudden, no, it was going to be clawed back. So when Lincoln fights this bill and then carries the fight on over new mutations of slavery's expansion, such as the Dred Scott decision, he appeals to the founding fathers and he appeals to Jefferson. Now, Jefferson is a complicated man. He had a very long career and he softened on certain of his ideas as he aged. But the Jefferson that Lincoln appeals to is the young Jefferson, 33 years old, who wrote the Declaration of Independence. And Lincoln returns to it again and again. In his Peoria speech, he calls it the sheet anchor of American republicanism. A sheet anchor is the strongest anchor a ship has. That's what a ship puts down in a storm. And in 1854, the storm is coming. So Lincoln calls the Declaration our sheet anchor. In 1859, he's invited to go to a celebration of Jefferson's birthday in Boston, and he can't come. But he sends a tribute to Jefferson, which he clearly labored over, and hoping it would be reprinted in newspapers, which it was. And he says, all honor to Jefferson, who had the forecast and the courage to put into a merely revolutionary document a principle for all time and for all ages. And then finally, the culmination of his engagement with Jefferson is the Gettysburg Address that I began with, where he begins 47 years ago. And 1863 minus 87 equals 1776. So it's back to that declaration and those principles that Lincoln is turning. Now, he was speaking at Gettysburg to dedicate a cemetery. There had been a lot of cemeteries in his life. His mother died when he was 9. His sister died when he was 20. His first sweetheart died when he was in his early 20s. He served in one war, the Black Hawk War. This was an Indian war in northern Illinois. He saw no action, but he did see a group of men who'd been scalped. And he remembered it on the top of every head, there was a spot the size of a silver dollar. And he said, blood seemed to be everywhere. And this I think, was a common experience of death in early 19th century America. These kinds of things happened often, and they happened to a lot of people. One man in Lincoln's cabinet, Salmon P. Chase, the Treasury Secretary, he lost 3 wives. 3 of his wives died, 1, 2, 3, one right after the other. So we all die, but there was a lot of visible mortality along the way in the early 19th century. But the Civil War was unusual. That was more than normal. And the political elites and the leadership class were not insulated from it. Lincoln had a law student named Elmer Ellsworth. He was a young Illinoisan who took the train with him on the way to his first inauguration. He's killed early in the Civil War in the Union taking of Alexandria. At the end of 1861, Edward Baker, who's one of Lincoln's friends from Illinois politics, Lincoln named one of his sons after Baker, he is killed at the Battle of Ball's Bluff. And someone at the funeral said that Lincoln wept like a child. William McCullough was court clerk in Bloomington, Illinois. Lincoln knew McCullough from the circuit. When he rode the circuit arguing cases, McCullough was the clerk in Bloomington. When the war begins, McCullough asks the new president for help to get into an Illinois regiment. He needs Lincoln's help because he's 50 years old and he's missing an arm. He lost an arm in a farming accident, but he wants to fight anyway. And Lincoln gives him his recommendation. He becomes a colonel of his regiment. And he's killed in December 1862 in the run-up to Vicksburg. And Lincoln writes a famous letter to his daughter, Fanny, who seems to have taken her father's death very hard. And that's the letter where Lincoln says, the young take tragedy hard because they're not used to it. You know, older people, we know that it's our lot. But you multiply these deaths by factors of 10 and 100 and 1,000. And also as commander-in-chief, Lincoln is the man to whom all the casualty figures come. It's all coming to him. Sometimes he sees the wounded. There was a reporter, Noah Brooks, who knew him from Illinois, younger man. He moved out to California, and the Sacramento Union sent him to Washington to cover the war. And he went with the Lincolns one day to visit a military hospital. This was something the Lincolns did. And as Brooks and the president are going down the line of beds, ahead of them is a charitable woman who's handing out tracts. And she gives one soldier takes her pamphlet, and he looks at it, and he drops it with a kind of a laugh. And Lincoln and Brooks come up to him, and Lincoln says, well, you know, she's trying to be helpful. It probably wasn't nice to laugh at her. And he said, Mr. President, she gave me a tract on the sin of dancing, and both my legs have been blown off. So, and that has the shape of a joke, but the joke is on the president and, of course, on the legless soldier. And so you multiply this and multiply this. The Battle of Gettysburg, is, we speak of it as the turning point in the war, and certainly Lincoln hoped that it was, but that was in July of 1863, and the Gettysburg Address is November, and by then the war has gone over 2 years, and that's as long as the Mexican War, the War of 1812, the other 19th century wars, but it's still going on, and it goes on and on. And the problem for Lincoln, which leads him to turn to his last father, is why is this happening? And I said earlier that Paine was not an atheist, and Lincoln never was an atheist himself. He always believed in God. Lincoln was also a determinist. All his life, he seems to have been a determinist. The particular Baptist church that his parents belonged to believed in predestination. So Lincoln left the Baptist, but I think he kept the doctrine of predestination. And he believed that every act has a cause, and that cause has another cause, and so on, back and back and back. And these are inescapable. These chains of causation are inescapable. One of his phrases that his law partner, William Herndon, heard him use over and over again is, the motive is born before the man. So before you're even born, the chain that will lead to all your actions is already forming. And so where do all these chains go back? Well, of course, they go back to God. God made the world. God rules the world. And so Lincoln thinks to himself, here we are in this war. God could have stopped it. Could have stopped it before it began. He could stop it any day. Any day he could make it stop. But he's not. And Lincoln writes a note to himself in 1862. He says, God rules. He could not be for both sides at the same time. But he may not be for either side. The war continues. Therefore, God must will it. God wants it to continue. Now, this note was saved by his secretaries, John Hay and George Nicolay, and they said that it was not meant to be seen of men. It was a private note for Lincoln. And he talked about it rarely to a few people. But his final thoughts and his final conclusions were in the second inaugural address, which he gives in March of 1865. He's been reelected. It looks like the war is winding down, but it is still going on. And here's what he tells the American people in the most religious, I think, public speech that any president has ever given. If we shall suppose that American slavery is one of those offenses which, in the providence of God, must needs come, but which, having continued through his appointed time, he now wills to remove, and that he gives to both North and South this terrible war as the woe due to those by whom the offense came, shall we discern therein any departure from those divine attributes which the believers in a living God always ascribe to him? If God wills that it continue until all the wealth piled by the bondman's 250 years of unrequited toil shall be sunk, and until every drop of blood drawn with the lash shall be paid for another drawn with the sword, as was said 3,000 years ago, so still it must be said, the judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. You can see from that how far Lincoln has come from Paine. I mean, Paine said as a little boy he was revolted by the notion that God could require the sacrifice of his own son as a payment for man's sins. Lincoln is now saying many sons, thousands of American sons, must die to pay for the nation's sin. And you also notice who isn't in this speech. There are no founding fathers in this speech. It's one of the only important speeches of the last 11 years of his life where the founding fathers do not appear. The Gettysburg Address said 47 years ago, went back to 1776. The subtraction in this speech is 250 years of unrequited toil. 250 from 1865 is 1615. It's Jamestown, the first American colony, the first colony to buy African slaves. So the founding fathers are now, they are a featureless point in this 250 years of a national sin, which is being paid for, says Lincoln. But that's not the end of the speech. There's a last paragraph, one sentence. With malice toward none, with charity for all, with firmness in the right as God gives us to see the right, let us strive on to finish the work we are in, to bind up the nation's wounds, to care for him who shall have borne the battle, and for his widow and his orphan, to do all which may achieve and cherish a just and a lasting peace among ourselves and with all nations. And I noticed when I came to write about that, that so many of those verbs are two syllables. Strive on, finish, bind up, care for, do all, achieve, cherish. And I thought, it's like walking. It's as simple as walking. It's as hard as walking when you've walked so far and there's still so far to go. A month after that, Lincoln was murdered, and we still walk on. Thank you very much. Questions? Yes? Sure. So this is a little room. Speak up. Yes, sir.
I had two questions. Your last quote made me think about three. I wish that would be read at the VA every morning, about binding up the nation's wounds and caring for he who had borne the battle.
Right.
I don't normally think of Paine as one of the founders. Is that my problem, or is that something you're putting into the mix?
Well, look, he's an eccentric founder because he never has any responsibility. I mean, he holds no political office. He's not an officer. He was a clerk of a congressional committee for a couple of years in the old Congress, and that's the only responsible position he held. But he's I think he belongs in the mix because of his great eloquence as a writer and as a controversialist, and he certainly knew lots of founders. They knew him. He knew Washington personally. He knew John Adams. He knew Governor Morris. He knew Jefferson. Now, after he writes The Age of Reason, most of the founders drop him. Sam Adams is an interesting founder because he's probably the most radical one. I would say he's even more radical than Paine, because Paine writes a good game, but Adams will burn your house. You know, he'll send the mob out. But Adams is also the most pious of the founding fathers, the most conventionally pious. He was touched by the Great Awakening. And so he's very disturbed by the Age of Reason. And Paine has been in France. That's where he wrote the book. And he finally is able to come back to America. Jefferson sends a ship to bring him back. And Adams writes in this very aggrieved letter, and it's interesting how Paine responds. He doesn't like really duke it out with Adams, and I think that's because he respects his eminence and also the fact that they agree on everything political. I mean, these are the two radicals, right? So he doesn't want to pick a fight with them, and he's trying to brush it off rather than do a Bill Maher, you know. So, but that's why I include Paine. And also, clearly, Lincoln was affected by this guy. And we have Herndon says he read him. There are other people who knew him way back when who told Herndon, oh, yes, you know, he read Common Sense. And so he was one of those books that this kid out in Indiana was just, you know, grabbing onto and swatting up. Yes?
Yes, sir. Have you heard of the writings of Charles Chiniquay, who was a client of Abraham Lincoln when he was an attorney, former Roman Catholic priest? Chiniquay attributed a fascinating quote to Lincoln in his book, 50 Years in the Church of Rome, basically attributing, saying that he wasn't so much to the South he felt he was fighting as against the Roman Church, its Jesuits, and its slaves. It was the Roman Church that was the power behind them. And of course, the Roman Church supported Jefferson Davis, even in correspondence.
I don't buy that at all. Lincoln, there is an anti-immigrant party in the 1850s, the American Party, also called the Know-Nothing Party. And a lot of the immigrants about which they were alarmed were Catholics. I mean, they were Irish and Germans. Almost all the Irish were Catholics. Many of the Germans were Catholics. But Lincoln was never an American, you know, never agreed with them. When people would say, oh, he was an American way back when, Lincoln would always say, no, this isn't true, you know, make sure this is denied. There were Americans, they were part of the Republican coalition. Lincoln's Attorney General, Edward Bates, had been in the American Party. But his most important cabinet officer is William Seward, who was a Whig, but a very pro-Irish. He wanted to give state support to Catholic schools in New York. So he was, you know, he was out there in his friendliness to these Catholic immigrants. And religious bigotry of that kind is just not Lincoln. So I don't believe that for a minute. Yes, sir.
This question asks for a little bit of speculation. How do you think history would have been different in those 4 years following his assassination had he lived? How do you think he would have handled the radical Republicans in Congress and the desire to punish the South rather than to reintegrate them? From my understanding of the evidence is that Lincoln wanted to not punish them, but gradually, gently reintegrate them, as opposed to the radical Republicans in Congress and their
efforts. Right. Well, look, it's hard to imagine a worse term than his first. I mean, that has to be the worst term any president has ever had. But his second term would have been hellacious. I mean, it would have, you know, you have all the problems he already had, all the political ones, which is holding the Republican Party together, and it's a bear garden. You have Northern Democrats who are sometimes for you, sometimes traitors, basically. But now you've got the South. You have these the South filled with former rebels, and you also have freemen. You know, so this is like multiplying it by, you know, pick a big number. Now, Lincoln was a very cunning politician. He was able to hold the Republican Party together, and there were rebellions against him. He was able to snuff them out or wait them out. Salmon Chase tried to run for the nomination in 1864. Lincoln handled that brilliantly. Charles Fremont, who was their first presidential candidate in 1856, he tried to make another run in 1864. Lincoln handled him. There was a rebellion in his cabinet in 1862. They wanted Seward's head. Lincoln handled that beautifully. So he was a very cunning politician. Also, he's won, you know, that would have been going for him. And I think what people realized, had come to realize by the end of this war, as the war went on, people in the North anyway, was that this guy who was, you know, this hick, I mean, the rail splitter, and that made him very popular, but also a lot of people thought of, geez, you know, who is this guy? They saw his qualities, you know, just from dealing with him. And people saw them. You know, all the people who came to visit him in the White House because they had petitions, because they had sons who were in military jail, because they wanted a job, because they said, why didn't you free the slaves yesterday? You know, whatever it was. And there were dozens of these people. They just trooped through the White House. And Lincoln wanted to see them. He called it his public opinion baths. And so, he talked to them, and he talked to them. And then they go home, you know, and they tell people what they'd heard, what he was like. And those impressions, they just got out. They just got out. So people had a sense of this man. And it would have been hard. I think, you know, the last speech he gives, it's from the White House to a crowd on the White House lawn. He's looking ahead to his policy towards the South, his Reconstruction policy. And there has been a government in the state of Louisiana. It's applying to be recognized as the legitimate government of the state. They have abolished slavery. They have accepted the 13th Amendment. They don't let free blacks vote, however. Lincoln wants them admitted because he says, you know, look, we've come this far. Do we want to knock all this down and wait for something even better? Let's let them in, and then it can improve from this basis. It's the argument he makes. And he says in public for the first time that blacks in Louisiana who were veterans or the very intelligent ought to be allowed to vote. Now, one of the people in the crowd was John Wilkes Booth, and he said, that means nigger citizenship. It's the last speech you'll ever give. And we know what happened. But that was, you know, that was Lincoln's approach. Also, when he's dealing with the Confederate peace commissioners, which if you saw the Spielberg movie, that's an episode at the end of it. And it's well known to history. There's an effort to negotiate an early settlement of the war, and Lincoln sees three representatives of the Confederacy, and they meet off Hampton Roads on a boat. And it goes nowhere because their mandate is to arrange peace between our two countries, and Lincoln's mandate is to have peace in our common country. So they can't even begin. But one of these gentlemen says, he raises the awkward question, do you consider us traitors? And Lincoln says, that's about the size of it. And he says, well, Mr. Lincoln, we've about concluded that as long as you're president, we won't be hanged. So that was a sense that not all Southerners, but that many of them had. We know what Lee's surrender was not the last Confederate army. There was still a major one in the Carolinas under Joseph Johnston. He surrenders to Sherman. And Sherman has just learned that Lincoln has been assassinated. And he pulls Johnson aside. He wants to talk to him alone in a room. And he tells him what has happened. And Johnston said, this is a crime against the age. And, you know, that's partly that Johnston is not a murderer, he's a soldier. But he also realizes, well, gee, we have lost this thing, and this guy may be our best, you know, the only friend we have on the other side. So Lincoln is able to work with radicals, because he's got radicalism in himself. I mean, he doesn't just want, you know, he thought at first, well, we'll end slavery and then back to Liberia. You know, or Panama, or there's an island off Haiti, maybe we could do that. And then he sees that's not going to work. Nobody wants to go. He brings a party of black men into the White House to try and sell this idea, and no one bites. So he recognizes that. But and his attitude towards Southerners, he spent very little time in the 1850s railing about Southerners and what evil slave owners they were. I mean, Charles Sumner did that. But Lincoln didn't, and he said several times, you know, they're doing what we would do in their situation. If you grow up in a society of slavery, you're going to accept it. You're going to think it's good. That's why he thought it was vital to contain it. You know, because if it grows, then more people will think that. That's why we have to contain it, which is his original policy. And then the war, like, throws everything by the boards, and it ends up being abolished. Now, you know, the problem with that view is there's a certain naivete about it. I don't think Lincoln really understood the passion of secessionist sentiment. He was always expecting unionism to revive in the South. But the upside of it is he doesn't demonize Southerners. You know, doesn't do it. Their motives were born before the man also. So let's try and, you know, make this work. Could he have pulled it off? Not 100%, but certainly would have been better than Andrew Johnson. I mean, the big mistake this man made was to pick that guy as a running mate. And two presidents had died. They were both presidents Lincoln had supported, you know, Harrison and Taylor. So this had happened before. They hadn't been shot. They died of natural causes. But, you know, we knew the vice presidency was not just a ceremonial thing. And yet they picked Johnson, and we got what we got. Yes, sir. Well, look, Lincoln is a politician. I mean, he knows what people think and feel. I think that's a little too economic an interpretation. I mean, Lincoln isn't just reluctant to be pro-abolitionist. He's not an abolitionist. I mean, he always denies that he is. Because in addition to the Declaration, there is the Constitution. And he always says, I hold to both of these, and I hold to both of these equally. You know, and he points out that the Constitution never names slavery, and that it also allows the slave trade to be ended in 1808, which it was. But he also admits there are certain guarantees in there, the three-fifths rule, the return of fugitive slaves. He accepts a national fugitive slave law. He'd like there to be trials. Now, that's the deal breaker by 1861. No Southern diehard is going to accept trials. And in fact, that was stripped out of the bill in 1850. Clay's original bill in the Compromise of 1850 had a provision for, you know, some sort of trial for a black man who's grabbed. You know, he can prove, well, no, I'm a free man. I'm not this guy's slave. And Lincoln is saying maybe we should have something like that. Well, that is not going to please Jefferson Davis, you know. But he, you know, so, and he's also, he's a very small C conservative man in a lot of ways. It is wrong to hold slaves as property, and yet they are held as property, and therefore people who own them have a certain stake there and a certain right, and he's always for compensation. I mean, he's still pushing compensation schemes as late as 1862. You know, he cooks up a deal for Delaware. He figures Delaware is the small slave state that stayed in the Union. You know, that'll be the easiest case. So he goes to Delaware and all right, here's what we'll pay you, and all your slaves will be free by 1893. Will you take it? They don't. And then the Emancipation Proclamation, of course, has nothing to do with slaves in Delaware or Kentucky or Missouri or Maryland. Nor does it have to do with places in the Confederacy that the Union has already conquered. It's only slaves of rebels who are still in rebellion, because that's Lincoln's only authority to do this as president. And then what finally happens is an amendment, you know, which goes through Congress, and then after he's dead, the states ratify it. But, you know, he's always moving, you know, he's the great revolutionary and the great liberator, but he moves very carefully and very cautiously. And it's partly being political, it's partly being legal. You know, and those are always parts of the man, along with the poet and the visionary. Yes, sir.
You talk about, you know, Lincoln spent his time studying the example of people who came before him, but I'm curious to know who his political mentors were, the contemporaries of his who
knew him. There was a man in Illinois named David Stewart, whom he met in the Black Hawk War. And Stewart was older. He was already a lawyer and a politician. And he helped Lincoln. He loaned him law books when Lincoln was studying the law on his own. And he took him under his wing when Lincoln starts being a state legislator for 8 years in Illinois. Stewart will not become a Republican. Stewart is actually elected in 1862. He's elected in Lincoln's district as a Democrat. And Lincoln tries to lobby him in 1864 to support the 13th Amendment, and he won't do it. So that's an irony. But the famous figure was Henry Clay, who was just this gaudy, great Whig, you know, figure, inescapable. Lincoln had some problems with Clay. He thought he was a selfish politician. You know, just always running for president. Ran three times, wanted to run twice more. You know, just trying to suck up all the atmosphere and hog it. Clay's last hope is 1848, and Lincoln supports Taylor, Zachary Taylor. He's a Taylor man. You know, Clay's had his chance. He's had more than his chance. Let's go with the war hero. But he admires Clay's economic program, and he also he uses and quotes a number of times a speech Clay gave to the American Colonization Society. And this was, you know, free the slaves, send them back to Liberia. Well, not back, they didn't come from Liberia, but send them to Liberia. And the paragraph that Lincoln singles out is Clay rebutting slave owners who criticized the society for putting ideas in the minds of blacks. You know, don't do this, you'll stir them up with dreams of freedom. And it's this very eloquent paragraph where Clay says, you know, here we have this problem of slavery, here's our solution. You say it's going to stir up blacks, but in order to not stir them up, you have to do more than shut us up. You have to do more than suppress this society. You have to muzzle the cannon that celebrate the 4th of July. You know, you have to blow out the moral lights around us. Then you have to do more. You have to go into the heart of man and extinguish the desire for liberty there. And only then will people not be stirred up. And that's a very Lincolnian paragraph. It's very logical. It goes from the news to the 4th of July, you know, to the human heart. It's like the news to history to human nature. And Lincoln loved that paragraph, and he quoted it many times. So that's the bit of rhetoric from Henry Clay that he most prized. Yes, sir. Okay, last question.
I understand you go into this in your book, but I'm interested in Lincoln's, I think, unorthodox religious views before the war, and then the war changed those views, and you were talking about this concept of God might change that.
Mm-hmm.
The war would change a lot of people's views.
Right.
Would you go into that a little bit?
Well, you know, it's hard to give you details because Lincoln is not forthcoming about this. He never keeps a diary, he never keeps a journal, no memoirs. Most of his letters are just all business. There are a few little hints, and I talk about one of them in my book. He has an encounter in the White House with a Quaker woman named Eliza Gurney. And I think she's the first person that he directly reveals some of this thinking to. But my, you know, my short answer is, you know, we don't know. It's very hard to track. There's another story, Joshua Speed, who's probably the only friend he ever had. And they lived together for 4 years in Springfield, and then Speed went back to Kentucky, which is where he was from. But Speed did visit him in the White House. And on one of those occasions, Speed said he saw Lincoln reading the Bible. And Speed said, well, I don't believe that. I still don't believe that book. I mean, he's obviously referring to a past of discussions that they had 20 years earlier when they were young men. And Lincoln said, no, Speed, you're wrong. You know, you have to read this book. Now, but what did he mean by that? What did he take from it? Did he believe in Jesus as his savior? I see no sign that he did. I don't see any sign that he didn't. I mean, he didn't say, no, I don't accept this. Clearly, the language, he loves the language, and it's in his head. And clearly, this notion of a God exacting punishment for national sins, that's very much in the Bible, in the Old Testament. So we only have hints. We have some eloquent hints, and that's it. Okay, thank you very much for your patience.
Thank you, Richard, and thank all of you for coming. I've just completed with my students some reading of Lincoln, to remind you how wonderful of a writer he is. And who would have thought we need yet another book on Abraham Lincoln? But having said that, I've been reading this one, and like your previous books, Washington, Lord Washington being one of my favorites, it's wonderfully written and wonderful prose that captures the man. This theme of Lincoln and the founders is wonderful, and thank you for doing that. You're always welcome here at Hillsdale. We'll get you out to the mothership as well. Thank all of you for coming. Have a wonderful evening. Thank you.